Welcome. I'm Jesper Pedersen from QTopia Core. You just entered the third module in this series on programming with Qt and QML. Up until now, we've learned how the QML language works, property bindings. We learned about elements and properties and so on. We learned how we make our user interface look different by using rectangles or images or, well, we haven't seen many more elements than that, but we saw that we could create an analog clock by just taking a few images and rotating them around. If the story ended here, your applications would be rather user unfriendly, because a user wouldn't be able to provide any input but just typing text into line edits. So we need to go a bit further. In this module here, we're going to talk about three different things. First thing is this, the finger or a mouse. So simple touch input using mouse or finger. Next one is going to be gestures, so swiping or zooming or press and hold or, well, a few more gestures. And the last video in this module here is keyboard input and focus area. How does that work? Stay tuned for the other two. Now we'll talk about mouse and touch input. So let's look at this code. Pretty simple code. We got a rectangle with two text elements inside them, and each of the text elements has a mouse area inside it. The mouse area fills the parent, so the mouse area size is the full size of this text element. Whenever I press down the mouse button, I update the parent color to be green. Whenever I release, I turn it back to be black. So press down, release, press down, release. I got another one down here that says anchors fill parent again, and this time it says unclicked, and clicked means pressed and released. That's a click. So whenever it's clicked, the boldness of the element should be toggled. Press, release. That was a click. Press, release. That's another click. I'll bet you if you play with QML, you already have seen this. Otherwise, let's just make a fool out of a good friend of mine that is called Jesper Pedersen. He works in QTopia. Wait that minute, that would be me. I was at CES once. I had a very important customer and I was showing him QML and I did exactly this mistake. So even somebody that knows a bit of QML can make this mistake. I'll just show it to you so that you at least have seen the mistake. If you can please go ahead and close your eyes now so you will not see the change I do to my code here. And you can open them again and you'll see that my user interface looks exactly like it before. I got a blue rectangle and I got two text elements inside it, but notice, it doesn't really work. And now for the next 10 minutes, you can ponder, what did he change? Or I can just press undo, anchor fill parent. What's the size of the mouse area by default? Oh yeah, you're right. 0 pixels wide, 0 pixels height. So 0 by 0, that is really, really difficult to hit that non-existing pixel. That's why we need the anchors fill parent. The anchor fill parent in here is what makes sure that this mouse area has exactly the size of the text. And if I run it now, you'll notice that I can press and release anywhere on top of this text here. Cannot press and release outside, obviously. I can click this one. Cannot click, well, even this one extended all the way down there. But I cannot click out, well, also extended down there, but nothing over here. So do remember that your mouse area is by default is 0 times 0 pixels, so you need to make sure that they have a size. Let me show you the same example, or similar example, text on blue background, so pretty same, right? This time, however, whenever I press down, it turns green, just like before. But this time, however, I do it in a slightly different way. I got my mouse area here. I say anchor fill parent, learned my lesson, and I give it a name. The color of the text is mouseArea.pressed? Green or black. If this is your first video, you will say, hey, that assignment that you have there, how will that ever work? And that's a good time for you to go and start from the beginning, or at least find the video on property binding. This is not an assignment, it's a property binding. It says that the color should be, if it's pressed down, then it should be green, and if it's not pressed down, it should be black. And it is, or if the property pressed is true, then it should be green, otherwise it should be black. Whatever value it has at any given point in time. So whenever the value down here is changing of that property, QML will realize, hey, this, the right side of my property binding here changed, it will reevaluate and the color will be a new color. I've been on it a few times. I like to do declarative programming in QML and do imperative programming in C++, not the other way around. Therefore, if I were to write a linter on QML, I would search for the equal sign and I would print out a warning. Every time there's an equal sign, that means that you're doing imperative programming in QML. You should try and avoid that. And if we go back here on the previous slide, what color is the text? Let me see the text. This doesn't say color. Oh yeah, I have a mouse area down here that changes it between green and black. Over here, what color is the text? Well, it's either green or black. See, that's what declarative programming is about. That I can, by just reading the color property, I have the whole state right here. It's a minor thing, but once we get much larger applications where the amount of code is split out over a long distance, then having that information about the property's value in one place rather than split out over many places is really, really worthwhile. We cannot talk about MouseArea without looking a bit we cannot talk about MouseArea, that's what I'm trying to say, without looking at the properties of MouseArea. And it has a number of different properties. The one that this slide was talking about was the accepted button. And the accepted button really basically tells which button on your mouse does the mouse area actually listen to. Also, if you look at the mouse area here, you'll see that there's a number of properties for drag. That is a drag and drop support. There might be a video in the future, I don't know, about drag and drop in QML. If not, then at least these are the properties that you will have to read up on to understand how drag and drop works. And then the hover enabled by default, whenever, if you're using a mouse, not your fingers, but if you're using a mouse, then when you move the mouse around on top of an element, then, or on top of a mouse area to be specific, then the mouse area will not have its property or its signal handlers executed. But if you set the hover enabled to true, then just moving around without pressing down a mouse button, that will already have its position changed, I believe. Let's just see again. Signals, double click, cancel, position changed, yeah. That signal will only be emitted if the mouse button is pressed down and you move around, unless you have hover enabled set to true. Another thing we need to talk about is event propagation. So usually it's not a big deal, but if you are in a complex setup, possibly with some drag and drop in the picture, you sometimes need to say, hey, I do not accept this. And then you might have multiple mouse area on top of each other with different responsibilities. And in those situations, you will be able to say, hey, I know that I got a mouse area, I got a mouse interaction happening on me being the mouse area here, but I do not accept it. Let it go down the set stack to somebody below me. And we have an example of that exactly here. Let me just try and run this in Qt Creator. You got a red and a yellow rectangle here. If I click the yellow, we can see upper rectangle clicked. If I click the red, lower rectangle pressed, released, and clicked. And in the overlap here, it's still only the upper one that is pressed, released and clicked. However, if I go down here and I change my mouse area, accept it to be false. So this is the yellow rectangle. I press and I say, hey, I don't accept this one. Then it will go onto the red one. So I press now in the overlap. Well, I press outside here. It just say upper rectangle pressed. It will not get the release because it said, I'm not interested in this press. So it will not get the release. But if I go and click here, or press here on the overlap, you can see upper rectangle pressed, upper rect. Well, that was the first line was from the previous press. So upper rectangle pressed, now lower rectangle pressed. And when I release, lower rectangle released, lower rectangle clicked. So there, the press simply fell through to the lower rectangle. I also got two other configurations here. Propagate composed event. That means clicked event. So clicked is one of those composed events. So if I do not accept my release, then the lower one did not see the press, but it will still get the clicked. So it goes like this. So press, release, and it turns into a click. Press, it's still only the upper that saw the press, release. The upper saw the release, therefore the upper got the click, but I am propagating composed events, so the clicked goes also to the red one. If you're sitting there saying, oh my God, I better go somewhere else now because this is just too complex for me, don't worry, it's not something that you do every single day. On the other hand, if I only showed you all the sunny day scenarios, you could just as well, I don't know. I'm gonna show you some corner cases, and this is one of those corner cases. If you're schizophrenic, first of all, I'm sorry, but then you can have a chat with yourself on this in two teams. Otherwise, find a coworker or in the message area below, give me your best shot. Do you prefer property bindings or do you prefer signal handlers? This slide here comes from our class where we'll have multiple people and we'll ask them to form two teams and discuss this. One team coming up with arguments why we should do property binding, the other why we should do signal handlers, and then the truth is likely somewhere in between. The last example I'm going to show you here is one that I wrote when I was still kind of learning QML. And it was, to me, it made me understand the whole concept or the whole difference between a property binding and an assignment. See, understand what declarative was really about. Well, my learning experience of what is declarative really about was multiple stages, but this was definitely one of those. So let me show you an example here. I got three rectangles. Let's see what it looks like. I got one that is green. I got one where move into me and one that says click me. Nothing works in this setup yet. So move into me. I would like that one to be done in the declarative way. So I got my rectangle here, that's my focus box. I got the yellow one that says move into me. And what I'll do is that the color of my focus box here should be focus area dot contains mouse. So if it contains the mouse, then it should be green. Otherwise it should be one of my favorite colors, cyan. So now it do not contain the mouse, so it's cyan. Now I move it into its green, move it out again, it's cyan, move it into its green, you get the idea. And now the click me over here, I'll do that in imperative programming style. So my mouse area here, I will say unclicked. And what did we call it up here? We call it focus box. Focus box. Dot color equal to, it's not a property binding anymore. I'm writing a JavaScript expression. So focus box dot color equal to, what should we make it? Blue. Okay, observe. Not containing color, or not containing the mouse, containing the mouse, not containing the mouse. Click, it's blue. Containing the mouse, oh wait, not containing, not, that doesn't work anymore. Why doesn't it work? Well, I'm sure that I was the Mr. Slow when I learned this. For me, it was a bit of pondering. Really? If you're with me there on the pondering, let me just tell you. So we got somewhere, we got in memory some information about what the color should be. The color should be, and then it's a property binding. It's basically a function that could be evaluated to get the color. And it, the function says if it contains the mouse, then it should be whatever the color was. Otherwise, it should be whatever the other color was. That is the function. But now I click, and as I click, I will go and get the text color in there. I'll get the blue color straight into that cell. And now the function is gone, obviously. The property binding is gone. This is what happens when you mix imperative programming, where you assign to properties, with declarative programming, where you have property bindings. I cannot encourage you enough to try and avoid those assignments, because you will get in trouble. I leave it as an exercise for you to figure out, how can I get both of these? Of course, you need to update. What does it mean? So perhaps when I click it the first time, it should be blue. And when I click it the next time, we should go back to the going between the two. You can do that by adding an extra custom property in there, and then make your property binding for the colors somewhat more complex. Anyway, that's what this video was about. Except one thing. I told you that there was be something about this little fin, this little fellow too, the finger. So how does a mouse touch on the user interface work? Well, it works exactly the same way as a mouse press. In the QML layer, whenever they see a single finger touch, they will convert that into a mouse press with the left mouse button. Now, if you have multiple fingers, or if you're doing swipe, or if you're doing zoom or something else, well, you better hang on. The next video is going to be about gestures. The video after that, we're going to talk about keyboard. But in the gesture video, we're both going to talk about swipe and whatever, and we're going to talk about multi-finger input. So stay tuned. Until then, have a great time.